Hello, I'm Eric Garloff, your host for Walking with Jesus. Today's program is titled, Our Need of Jesus. And I'm so happy you've joined us for this important topic. Now, whether or not you personally feel a deep need for Jesus, this program promises to be a blessing to you, because anything that brings you closer to God is a blessing. Let's get started, shall we? I've often heard it said that the more money a person has, the less he or she feels a need for God in their life. Now, I know that this is not true of everyone, but the Bible has a passage which supports this general idea, and it's found in the book of Revelation, chapter 3, and verses 17 and 18, which says the following, "Because you say I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and don't know that you're wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that you may be rich, and white raiment, that you may be clothed, and that the shame of your nakedness do not appear, and anoint your eyes with eye salve, that you may see." And then Jesus says this in verse 19 and 20. He says, "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will dine with him and he with me." Now, packed within these four verses is quite a lot for a person to take into consideration. So let's break it down and take it one step at a time. This way we'll be able to understand its meaning as it applies to our need of Jesus. In their sinless state, Adam and Eve held joyful communion with God. But after their sin, they could no longer find joy in the presence of His holiness. Thus, they sought to hide from the presence of God. Such is still the condition of the unrenewed heart today. And there is no lack of things or attractions or appointments or whatever the case may be to keep our attention fixated upon. Now, it may be true that the more money a person has, the more things he has to draw his attention away with. But let me also say that someone who doesn't even have two nickels to rub together can just as easily turn away from knowing God as well. Thus, no matter who we are, we need to understand why it is that having God in our lives is so important. Paraphrased, the passage we read in Revelation chapter 3 stated that without Christ in our lives, we are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Now, we may not seem this way to ourselves, or to our neighbors, or to our coworkers. But the reality is that this is the way God sees us, if we're living without Jesus. This is why He says, "I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that you may be rich." The gold tried in the fire represents a loving and a living faith, which has been tried and purified. True faith is a symbol of spiritual riches. Our nakedness mentioned in this passage is a symbol of not being prepared. You may well remember the parable in the Bible where a man came to a wedding feast and he didn't have on the wedding robe. This man was then thrown out because he didn't come prepared. The white raiment or white robe that we are told to buy is a symbol of the robe of Christ's righteousness. It's only by His righteousness that we can be saved. Thus, it's only by Christ's righteousness that we can be prepared to meet God. Finally, the passage also said we're blind. Well, if we're blind, we can't see where we're going, can we? This is a symbol of spiritual blindness, and unless we apply the cure for our blindness, we will remain in spiritual darkness. That cure is to obtain the eye salve that God has mentioned. This eye salve opens our eyes to our true condition. Opening our eyes is the work of the Holy Spirit. The eye salve represents the Holy Spirit, and only through His convicting work on the heart can spiritual blindness be removed. So here it is in a nutshell. God wants us to ask Him to give us the power of the Holy Spirit so we can see our true condition and to come to Him in faith, knowing that He will answer that prayer and clothe us with the robe of Christ's righteousness, that we may be saved. That's absolutely fantastic, isn't it? And it's all the gift of God, amen? Jesus said it was like Him standing at the door and knocking. And if anyone would hear his voice and open the door to him, he will come in. The door is a symbol of our heart. So if we hear Jesus speaking to our heart and invite him in, he will come in and live within us. The book Steps to Christ, page 8, has this to say about our condition. It is impossible for us of ourselves to escape from the pit of sin in which we are sunken. Our hearts are evil, and we cannot change them. Education, culture, the exercise of the will, human effort, all have their proper sphere. But here they are powerless. They may produce an outward correctness of behavior, but they cannot change the heart. They cannot purify the springs of life. There must be a power working from within, a new life from above, before men can be changed from sin to holiness. That power is Christ. His grace alone can quicken the lifeless faculties of the soul and attract it to God, to holiness. The Savior said, "Except a man be born from above, unless he shall receive a new heart and desires, purposes and motives leading to a new life, he cannot see the kingdom of God." If you're still not sure about all of this, if you still think that you've lived a pretty good life and that you really haven't done anything bad, at least nothing worthy of death, and that God will take you to heaven anyway, then let me share this thought with you. Suppose you had a child, let's say it was a boy, and for the past 12 years, you've raised this boy, you've poured out upon him all of the love, nurturing, and caring that any parent could possibly give their child. The bond between the two of you is so great that it could never be broken. When he is hurt, you feel his pain and his suffering. And if there were anything that you could do to relieve it, you would sell all that you had to make it so. Over the years, as you raise your son, you had seen him through good times and through bad. When you reflect back on his life, you can recall the incidents that brought you the most joy and also those which caused you the most pain. It's the painful ones which you wish you could undo as if they never happened. One such occasion happened to your son a number of years ago when another boy in the neighborhood who was an orphan and lived right down the street was very mean and nasty to your son. He would lie in wait for him after school and beat him up. He would play dirty tricks on him and make fun of him every day. Even though you spoke to the orphanage about his behavior and did everything that you could to stop this from happening, the boy just didn't stop beating up your son. Then one day, the boy moved to another orphanage across town, and everything was back to normal again. Your heart was relieved that your son no longer had to put up with that abuse. A few months later, your son comes to you and tells you that the boy had gotten sick, and that nothing short of a heart transplant could save his life. Now, here's the difficult part to imagine, because the medical community today would not allow this to happen. But your son finds out that his heart is a perfect match to save the life of the one who bullied him and beat him up. So your son comes to you and tells you that he loves you so much, and that he wants to show the bully the same kind of love that the two of you share with each other, because he has never known that kind of love himself. This news breaks your heart because you know your son is asking to give up his life, to give the bully his own heart that he could live. You just don't know how to react to this. You don't know if you can bear such a thing, because just thinking about it, your heart is breaking. It's like tearing your own heart right out of your chest. You hunt and search for another way to save the boy's life, but you realize the only way for the bully to live and to know true love is to allow your son to go through with his plan. Then after the operation is over and your son gave everything he had to save the life of the bully, you find it within yourself to love the bully. You adopt him and you give him your name. You give him all of the love that you had given to your own son. Gradually, the boy realizes what it's like to be loved, what it's like to have someone care for him and protect him. The boy realizes the infinite sacrifice that was made on his behalf, and he grows up with the utmost love and respect for the boy who gave his life that he might live. Friend, that's what God the Father and Jesus his Son have done for you and for me. The Bible says that they did this because of our sin. If there had been any other way to save us, God the Father would have found it. The very fact that Jesus had to die so that we could live is the strongest testimony of God's love for us. If we don't accept the sacrifice of Jesus, we are refusing the life which he died to give to us. Our great need of Jesus exists because we have sinned. And because we have sinned, we need a Savior. The Bible says in Romans 3:23 that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. 1 John 1:10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar. Two verses before this, in 1 John 1:8 we read, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. And finally, Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see, my friend, we are all doomed to die with a bad heart, for we have all sinned and all come short of God's standard. Because we come short of it, we cannot expect to have salvation without accepting the death of Jesus on our behalf. It's only by acknowledging our own sinfulness through the power of the Holy Spirit, which God will give us, if we ask him for it, and by accepting the sacrifice of Jesus, that we can be clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness, making us righteous in the eyes of God. He then takes us into his family and loves us with the same love that he has for his Son. God has loved us from the very beginning, but he cannot bring us into heaven to live with him unless we have received a new heart. Friends, God is truthful, honest, and just. He is the only one in the universe in which you can place your total trust. He has promised us life through his Son Jesus. And if we accept Jesus, God will fulfill his promise to us. Once again, Jesus says in Revelation 3:20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will eat with him and he with me. And in the very next verse, verse 21, Jesus says, to him that overcomes will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. Yes, friend, our need of Jesus is so great that we won't get to heaven without him. Ephesians 2:8 and 9 says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. As we close now, I would like to say a prayer. And if you feel the need of Jesus in your life, you can repeat this prayer in your heart and make it your own prayer. Father, I come to you, the creator of the universe, and I realize that there's no hope for me outside of Jesus, your Son. Father God, please give me your Holy Spirit that I may see my true condition. Please forgive me of my sins and cleanse me. Place the robe of Jesus' righteousness upon me, because without it, I won't be able to live with you. Lord, by faith, I believe that you have heard this, my prayer, and have forgiven me and cleansed me. And in the name of Jesus, I thank you, Father. Now help me to live my life accordingly. In Jesus' name, amen. May God be with you.
Our faith grows when we walk with Jesus. His love, mercy, compassion will guide us along the path of life. And we pray you desire a close walk with him. Join us for our next exciting program as we discuss the subject of repentance.